Okay, everybody, we'll start now. I'm Jerry Garfinkel. I'm the treasurer of the Jewish Studies Center. I want to welcome you all to one of our many, many great classes. This will be even greater than the usual great classes about the Jews in Tin Pan Alley. But as treasurer, I do want to tell you that even though our classes are free, we do have expenses, and we appreciate if you make a donation. If you go to our studies, to our website, www.jewishstudiescenter.org, and you click on donate and fill out the form, and you can donate either by PayPal or by credit card or by check. And if you donate by check, it'll give you the address of where to send your check. Okay, now a few technical points. As you probably are seeing, this session is being recorded. So it'll really, I'll have people spotlighted who are speaking, so people in the gallery probably won't be seen. But if for some reason you want to make sure you're not seen, just turn your video off. I will also right now put on the live transcript, neighbor auto transcript. That's right. And then you can actually see the words, or at least the approximation of the words. One other thing, our motto is come learn with us. So if you have any topic you'd like to teach, or topic you'd like to learn about that has Jewish content, please email us at info@jewishstudiescenter.org and give us your ideas or your volunteer situation. Okay, the other thing is that if you put your questions or comments in the chat, I believe that Seth we'll be looking at the chat every once in a while, and we'll address your questions or your comments. If not, at the end of the session, Seth or Mindy will address some of the questions. So at this point, I want to introduce Mindy Reiser, who is our vice president, and she'll introduce Seth. Mindy, take it away, please.
Okay. Good to see most of you folks in the little boxes. Okay. Some of you were here last week and you've heard an introduction of Seth, but not everybody was here last week. So I will give you an abbreviated version. Seth is a man of many parts, and we're just going to feature some background on a few of those dimensions. So, Seth Kibel is one of the Mid-Atlantic's premier woodwind specialists, working with some of the best bands in klezmer, jazz, swing, and more. He's been wowing audiences on clarinet, saxophone, and flute, and you'll hear some of these instruments tonight, and piano. There he is by the piano, you'll see later. He's made a name for himself in the Washington-Baltimore region and beyond, and tonight very much beyond, because I know some of you are in Canada, some of you may be on the West Coast, some of you may be in Europe or Israel or Australia. If you are, let us know. We always get a kick out of that. He is the featured performer with the Klezetet, the Bay Jazz Project, Music Pilgrim Trio, the Natty Bow, and more. These are very interesting names. He's the winner of 28 Washington Area Music Awards. They're called Whammies, including the Best World Music Instrumentalist from 2003 to 2011, and the Best Jazz Instrumentalist 2005, 2007, and 2011. His most recent recording, When You're Smiling, that has a long history, that song. That was released in 2018 on the Azalea City Recording record label. His song, New Waltz, won the grand prize of the 2016 Mid-Atlantic Song Contest, and that was sponsored by the Songwriters Association of Washington. These all have acronyms, and if you're interested, you could find them. When Seth is not performing, he frequently lectures, as tonight, but it's a combination of performing and lecturing, on a variety of topics in music history for a variety of institutions, including the OSHARE Lifelong Learning Programs at Johns Hopkins and Towson University. For more information, you can visit Seth on his website, www.sethkibel.com. And Seth is very good at handling anything that comes his way. So put your observations and questions, and he'll be responding to them. Seth, the floor is yours.
Okay. Thank you so much, Mindy. I appreciate it. And thank you, everyone from all over, for joining us this evening. It's great to once again be here in the Jewish Study Center, which looks suspiciously like my basement. Now, I know some of you were here last week for last week's program. If you missed it, don't worry. There are no prerequisites for tonight. Of course, last week's program is archived on YouTube. You should check it out. I was brilliant, insightful, witty, and charming. Okay, as Mindy mentioned, I strongly encourage you to avail yourself of Zoom's group chat feature. In fact, I would personally recommend that you hit that chat button right now so that it's off to the side of your screen. And anytime, doesn't matter if I'm talking, playing, whatever, you can type any questions, comments, concerns, queries, conundrums, conniptions in that chat window. I may not respond in real time, but I promise at several points during the presentation, I will inspect said chat box and do my best to address everything even remotely pertinent contained there within. I know right now everyone is chiming in with where they're watching from, which is great. I encourage you to be even more specific. Put your home address along with days and times you're usually not at home. Okay. Before I do anything else, I always like to get started with a little bit of music. Just to get my juices flowing and get everyone in the mood. Where we left off last week, I had done some talking about Mr. Isidore Israel Berlin, Irving Berlin, but there's more I want to do about Irving Berlin today. So I'm going to start by playing an Irving Berlin song. Now, there's a bit of a history behind this song. I'm going to tell you that history after I play it. But this is a song that is a staple at weddings to this day. Always. And if you know the lyrics, feel free to sing along. I don't care, because you're all muted. Thank you. Okay. Oh, thank you so much for your virtual applause. I do so appreciate it. So, for the backstory to always, let's talk a little bit about Irving Berlin's personal life. He marries for the first time in 1912, a woman by the name of Dorothy Getz. She was the sister of another songwriter, Ray Getz. Anyway, there they are, right there. That's Irving Berlin and Dorothy, and they go on a honeymoon to Cuba shortly after they get married, where Dorothy catches typhoid fever and dies 6 months later. I know, it's very sad. Okay, he finds love again. In 1925, he will become the talk of the town, and not necessarily in a good way, when he marries a wealthy Catholic socialite, Ellen McKay, daughter of Clarence McKay, the founder of the Postal Telegraph Company. And look, this was a big deal. A wealthy Catholic socialite marrying a Jewish songwriter from Tin Pan Alley. In fact, her family basically disowns their daughter. They will actually reconcile sometime later after their first child, Irving Berlin Jr., dies at the age of 1 month on Christmas Eve. Her parents decide to reconcile with Irving Berlin and his bride. But anyway, back to Ellen McKay. Here's a photo of wife number two with Irving Berlin. There they are, lovely couple. And Irving Berlin wrote this song always as a present for his bride. Now, I don't know, my wife like wanted jewelry and stuff like that. He wrote a song for her, he wrote Always, and I guess he meant it because they were married for 63 years. She died a year before him in 1988. And yes, indeed, that song became even more famous when it was featured in the movie Pride of the Yankees. And it's a great example of an Irving Berlin lyric. You know, I talked about this last week. Irving Berlin wrote his own lyrics. In fact, we're more certain he wrote all of his lyrics than we are that he wrote all the music, as I discussed briefly last week. And an Irving Berlin lyric is characterized by simplicity, sparseness. It reminds me of the old Strunken White admonition, omit unnecessary words. You know, other lyricists, Ira Gershwin and others and what have you, were characterized by wordplay and big vocabulary and clever rhymes and puns and jokes, all this brilliant lyrical genius. Irving Berlin has none of that. Again, your typical Irving Berlin lyric, if I were to submit it in a songwriting class, I would probably get an F, but they're perfect. Irving Berlin had a way of just kind of using just the right words, and sometimes the simplicity and directness of an Irving Berlin lyric is absolutely perfect. Always is a great example of that. The lyrics for Always: I'll be loving you always, with a love that's true always. When the things you've planned need a helping hand, I will understand always. Days may not be fair always, that's when I'll be there always. Not just for an hour, not just for a day, not just for a year, but always. I mean, that's as simple as you can get. There's literally no word with more than two syllables. Wait, no, understand. Sorry, understand is three syllables. Other than that, no word more than two syllables. And most of the rhymes are the word always rhyming with the word always. But it's perfect. It's a perfect song. Okay, I'm jumping around here because, as always, there's a lot I want to get to. I want to talk a little bit about another important chapter or segment of the Irving Berlin oeuvre, and that's what will eventually become This Is the Army. Now, the road to This Is the Army is kind of a long road. It starts in 1917 when Irving Berlin, already a very successful and established songwriter, is drafted into the Army. And the Army decides to put this Tin Pan Alley songwriter to work, and they task him with writing a musical for an all-enlisted soldier cast to have a limited run on Broadway to raise money for the war effort. The show that he comes up with is named Yip Yap Yap Hank, after Camp Yap Hank that was out on Long Island. And it has a successful limited run, raises $150,000 in 1917 dollars for the war effort. And yes, it includes the song, Oh, How I Hate to Get Up to the Morning. Okay, so fast forward now. World War I has its sequel a couple of days later, World War II. And in World War II, being the patriotic American he is, Irving Berlin wants to help the war effort. So he takes Yip Yap Yap Hank, World War I limited run Broadway musical, and kind of rewrites it, rehashes it, adds some new music, and it gets turned into This Is the Army. And This Is the Army, of course, becomes hugely successful. He puts together a whole army division to perform it. The first integrated division in the U.S. Army before Eisenhower integrated the U.S. military after the war. And they tour military bases, they tour Europe, they tour for about 3.5 years with the show. Irving Berlin doesn't get a single penny for it. He does it all for his country, which has given him so much. And then, of course, it's made into a 1943 film starring Joan Leslie and some actor by the name of Ronald Reagan. It raises, in total, more than $10 million for the U.S. war effort during World War II. All right, there's a lot more to talk about it. You're right, Truman integrated the military. You're right, Jerry. Thank you for keeping me honest. All right. Let me show you a clip from the This Is the Army movie. This is the clip where Irving Berlin himself makes a surprise appearance to sing his beloved Army song, Oh, How I Hate to Get Up in the Morning. You know, I have a really close connection to this. My close connection to this, some of you from the DC area, may remember a wonderful musician who was a stalwart of the DC scene for many years, and a good friend of mine named Seymour Green. Seymour Green was an institution, and he played well into his 90s. He passed away a few years ago at the age of 97 or 98. Anyway, one of Seymour Green was a trombonist, and one of his big claims to fame is that he was in the This Is the Army band. He played trombone for Irving Berlin. He's in the movie. You don't see him very clearly, but he's back there. And he worked, you know, with Irving Berlin for 3.5 years. And I worked with him a lot. So it's practically like I'm friends with Irving Berlin. All right, let me show you this clip from This Is the Army, and then we will continue our discussion. Bear with me. I want to make sure I get this queued up properly.
Come on, come on, it's time to get up. Come on, Sleeping Beauty, wake up. You gotta get up, you gotta get up, you gotta get up this morning.
A soldier quite a while, I would like to state, the life is simply wonderful, the army food is great. I sleep with 97 others in a wooden hut. I love them all, they all love me, it's very lovely, but oh, how I hate to get up in the morning. Oh, how I'd love to remain in bed. For the hardest blow of all is to hear the bugler call. You gotta get up, you gotta get up, you gotta get up this morning. Someday I'm going to murder the bugler. Someday they're going to find him dead. I'll amputate his reveille and step upon heavily and spend the rest of my life in bed.
Oh, how I hate to get up in the morning.
Pop, guy who makes the bugler up.
And I spend the rest of my life in bed.
All right. Whoops. Sorry. Let me get this. Nope. We don't want to watch it again. All right. There you have it. Irving Berlin with Oh, How I Hate to Get Up in the Morning. You know, I didn't even have this queued up, but I'm going to pull it up right now. Because I'm feeling mushy and sentimental. I want to show you a video of my friend Seymour Green doing this song. And this is a video that I actually posted a number of years ago. Where is it? I know it's in here. I know it's on YouTube. I posted it myself. Hold on 1 second. Let's find it here. Uh-oh. Where did it go? Interesting. Seymour Green. Oh, you know why? I bet I have to do that. No. All right, let's try this. Sorry, I'll give it one more minute. If I don't find it, I'm giving up. Oh, there we go. We found it. All right, hold on. This is my friend Seymour from just a few years ago.
Anyway. Supposed to run for 2 weeks and ran for 3.5 years, toured the country, made a movie. Warner Brothers, Ronald Reagan was with it. And yeah, he was a member of the cast of the movie. He was in the Army at that time also. He was a lieutenant. And then it went overseas for 2 years, traveled around the world. I was with the show from the very first rehearsal, first performance on Broadway, toured the country, and I was with it in the movie and so forth, all over the world.
Would you? Ah! All right, it got cut off. Sorry.
It was supposed to run for
All right, we'll just leave it there. So look, let's go back. Sorry, I'm having lots of computer issues tonight. Stop it. Okay. Whew. All right. Let's go back to Yip Yap Yank, the early incarnation of this show during World War I. Well, in Yip Yap Yank, Irving Berlin writes an anthemic song, a serious song expressing love for his country that he calls God Bless America. And he decides before the show's premiere, it just doesn't fit. It's just too serious. It doesn't fit with the tone of the show, which was very light and comedic. So it's cut from Yip Yap Yank. It doesn't even show up. Well, it does show up in This is the Army later. Anyway, fast forward now to 1938. Kate Smith needs a song for a radio program to mark the 20th anniversary of Armistice Day. Irving Berlin is asked to provide one. And like any good songwriter, rather than write something new, he goes into his closet and sees if he has anything back there collecting dust that can be used. And of course, he brings her God Bless America, and the rest is history. Now, one of the many famous things about God Bless America, you may know, is he signed the royalties for that song over to the Boy Scouts of America, Boy Scouts and Girl Scouts of America. And to this day, that song earns literally millions of dollars for the Boy Scouts and Girl Scouts of America. And it will continue to do so until it enters the public domain. And that's going to be a long time from now, because of course, Irving Berlin lived to be 101 years old. And songs don't enter the public domain until 75 years after the composer's death. So he died in 1989 plus 75. I don't know. That's like 2040 or something. Anyway, I want to show you a video now of God Bless America. And this actually is not a clip of Kate Smith singing it. Instead, I'm going to show you an appearance, a rare appearance of Irving Berlin singing this song himself in 1968, by which time he was working less and less and spending less and less time in the public eye. This is a clip from the Ed Sullivan Show with Irving Berlin singing God Bless America with the help of a small army of Boy Scouts. Now, I mean, I don't know any specifics behind this clip, but I do think about when it aired. This aired May 5th, 1968. Think about all that was going on in the United States in the middle of 1968. And it almost seems to me that this is a little bit of a political statement on behalf of either Irving Berlin and or Ed Sullivan. This is a highly patriotic, almost jingoistic presentation of God Bless America. I can't help but feel that this performance is in some way a reaction against other things that were going on in the United States at that time. I'm certain, at least, even if it wasn't intended that way, it would have been perceived that way by much of the audience. Let me show you this clip. This is Irving Berlin singing God Bless America on the Ed Sullivan Show, May 1968.
That I love, stand beside her and guide her through the night with a light from above, from the mountains to the prairies to the oceans white with foam. God bless America, my home, sweet home.
I mean, Irving Berlin basically came out of retirement to do that. I mean, he was either 79. Whoops, sorry. Oh, why does this keep happening? Okay. He had basically come out of retirement to do that. I mean, he was either 79 or 80 years old. Let's see, he was probably, when's his birthday? May 11th. That was May 5th. It was just a few days away from his 80th birthday when he did that. And he had basically retired. His last musical was a flop. It was Mr. President. It was 1962. And then from that point on, he basically rarely appeared in public and didn't write any new music. Really an interesting, fascinating clip when you think about the context. All right. Like I said, I'm going to jump around. There's a lot I want to do, but I want to play another song for you right now. I want to play something on clarinet because I haven't played that yet tonight. How about, I'm trying to remember what I did last week. Let me do, I'll jump back to someone we talked about last week, the Gershwins. And here's a song that is purported to be the final melody that George Gershwin ever wrote. And in fact, the lyrics for this song weren't written by his older brother, Ira, until after George's untimely passing, which paints them somewhat of a different light. This is Our Love Is Here to Stay. I didn't do that last week, did I? I don't think so. I don't want to repeat songs. All right. Did I do it last week? Then I'm going to do a different Gershwin song. How about Swonderful? It would be Swonderful if I played Swonderful. Wonderful. So, before moving on, I want to make sure to address a bunch of things that I've seen come up in the chat window. I'm going to try to scroll through this relatively quickly now. Okay, going way back. Oh, I know someone wanted to know why I didn't play the verse. I think they said preface, but preamble, but the verse to Always. You know, I mean, it does have a nice verse. A lot of these songs have nice verses, but honestly, most of the verses, the kind of introductions, if you will, to a lot of these great songs of the Great American Songbook, I think they don't work as well instrumentally. The melodies, the parts that translate well to an instrumental performance are the refrains, the choruses that everyone knows and loves so well. So I tend not to play verses a lot on my instruments. If I'm working with a vocalist, yeah, then a lot of times the verses can be nice and a nice way to set up the song. Okay, moving on. Yes, Cole Porter was another brilliant wordsmith. Not a Jew. By the way, there's a famous quote that Cole Porter said that's been often debated, and I'm not an expert enough to offer an opinion, but the quote is something to the effect of, "I didn't have a hit until I learned to write Jewish." And some people put that quote in a flattering light, saying that Cole Porter was inspired by his fellow Jewish songwriters. Other people have interpreted it to be a bit of a snarky comment on Cole Porter's behalf, because he was a very kind of acerbic personality. And yes, he had a lot of Jewish friends, but at the same time, he would simultaneously complain about the music business being dominated by Jewish songwriters. So it's hard to know when he said that, whether he really meant it in a flattering light or kind of a sarcastic light. In any case, let's move on. All right. Yes, Truman integrated the military. I lied about saying Eisenhower did it. Yeah. Kate Smith recorded some questionable songs. Now, if you're going to go down that road, a lot of people wrote and sang some pretty questionable songs. In fact, one of the worst offenders is Irving Berlin. Irving Berlin, ironically enough, was one of the chief songwriters of a genre that was known even back then as Hebe songs. What was a Hebe song? A Hebe song was a comical Tin Pan Alley song that played on stereotypes about Jews. There were songs that played on, there were Irish songs. There were a gazillion songs about the drunk Irishman. There were a million songs that made fun of Chinese people. There were, of course, a million songs that played on racial stereotypes against African Americans. And indeed, Irving Berlin wrote a lot of these. He wrote there's some song about the butcher who goes to the funeral and follows this guy down to get the quarters off his eyes because he owed him 25 cents. A lot of questionable songs. And, you know, sometimes people say, well, back then they didn't consider those types of songs offensive. Well, maybe not as offensive as they're considered today. But there were people back then who considered those songs offensive. In fact, George Gershwin was very outspoken and critical of Irving Berlin for writing Hebe songs and other songs that played on racial and ethnic stereotypes. So even though they may not have been outright condemned like songs like that would be today, there were people who said, you know, that's probably not appropriate. Anyway. George Gershwin, yes, I didn't talk about his death. He did die at age 38, I don't have my notes in front of me, of a brain tumor. A few weeks before he died, he started having headaches. Well, he had migraines for a while, but the headaches got worse. He started to smell burning rubber. Of course, we now know that's it. When they finally discovered he had a tumor, it was too late. I tend to say a lot of things that get me in trouble. I have a bad, you know, kind of a dangerous sense of humor. And I think one of the worst things I said ever is a number of years ago, I was privileged with a group of other musicians to tour the George Gershwin collection, get a private tour of the George Gershwin selection at the Library of Congress. Now, I don't know if you know this, if you live in the DC area, at the Library of Congress in, I get the buildings mixed up. I forget if it's in the Jefferson Building or the Madison Building. But they have a whole George Gershwin room that has a lot of his manuscripts. It has his piano. It has all these artifacts because they have the entire, basically, archive of George Gershwin. Anyway, I got this private tour. And the lovely, I'll say mature woman who gave us the guided tour at the end of it said, "Oh, I bet you have some magic songwriting talent having seen that piano." And without even thinking, I just kind of blurted out. I said, "No, but I think I now have a brain tumor." And she just looked at me with this look. I just remember this look of like, "You're a horrible human being." And I probably was. All right. Anyway. There are probably some good mathematicians for peace jokes I could come up with, but I'm not gonna do that right now. Okay, Anita asked a good question. When I was playing swonderful. How much of what I was playing was my own improvisation versus what Gershwin wrote? Well, let me address that. First of all, I kind of present a lot of these songs the way a jazz musician would, meaning I play the song, then I kind of play an improvisation. Like I make up my own melody, but I base it on the harmonic and rhythmic structure of the original song. Now, listening to me play solo woodwind, you might not be able to perceive that at first listen. But rest assured, in my head, I am hearing the rest of the band. I'm hearing a rhythm section, a piano, drummer, and bass player playing the accompaniment for that song while I'm improvising. I really am. I mean, that's something I've worked really hard to do. I have an imaginary rhythm section playing in my head. There's a little Seth playing drums, a little Seth playing double bass. He's wearing a beret. A little Seth playing drums. He drinks too much. The little Seth playing piano is smoking a cigarette, which he really shouldn't do. But I'm hearing that in my head. Now, when I play the melody, I still improvise in the way I embellish the melody. You know, I'm not just playing... You know, I'm adding other stuff. You could hear the melody, but I'm definitely adding other stuff to it. And if you asked me to play it the same exact way twice, I don't think I could. Okay. Did Berlin ever come to like versions of his songs recorded by acts like Elvis Presley and the Drifters, who both recorded R&B takes on White Christmas, or is it just the royalties that appealed to him? That's a good question, Ron. Irving Berlin did not outright criticize covers of his song. You know, every songwriter felt differently about it. Irving Berlin certainly liked the royalty checks. So if he disliked a lot of those covers, he kept his mouth shut. At the same time, he didn't go out of his way to praise them. The Gershwins, George when he was alive, and Ira for the rest of his life, he lived well into the 1970s, they loved it. Irving Berlin, I mean, Ira Gershwin loved when jazz musicians do their songs. I mean, one of the famous Irving Berlin, Ira Gershwin quotes that I love is he was asked about Ella Fitzgerald's interpretations of the Gershwin songbook, and his response was, "I never knew how good our songs were until I heard Ella Fitzgerald sing them." But then there were some songwriters who were more ornery about that. Jerome Kern, to some extent. Cole Porter did not like when other people interpreted his songs and didn't stay true to the original. I mean, a song that I'm going to talk about in a little bit, Jerome Kern's Smoke Gets in Your Eyes, Jerome Kern's widow actually sued to try to get the Platters not to release their version of the song because she felt that her late husband would not approve of a rock and roll band like the Platters singing his song. Yip Harburg, I'll get to him. Gershwin was 39, thank you, when he died in 1937. All right, that's a perfect segue. I want to move on now and talk a little bit about Mr. Jerome Kern. Now, from the very beginning, there are a couple of differences in the childhood and the upbringing of Jerome Kern and the people we've talked about thus far, namely George Gershwin and Irving Berlin. First of all, Jerome Kern was actually born with the name Jerome Kern. Secondly, unlike Irving Berlin and George Gershwin, Jerome Kern did not grow up poor. In fact, he grew up downright rich. He had a pretty cushy upbringing. His parents, Henry and Fanny Kern, were both German-Jewish immigrants, very well established. His father was an importer-exporter of luxury items from Europe, including pianos. In fact, there's a story that Jerome Kern used to tell that I don't know if I fully buy, because it seems a little bit implausible, but he says that after he finished, when he dropped out of school a few months before graduation, he went to work with his father, and then his father fired him when he was supposed to order 2 pianos from Europe and accidentally ordered 200 pianos from Europe. I don't know if that story really makes complete sense, but there you have it. Yes, he was very musically talented. He learned piano first from his mother and then from some various music teachers. He lived in Midtown Manhattan. He when he was in school, he wrote a musical. His first musical was in grade school. He wrote a musical adaptation of Uncle Tom's Cabin, which sadly has been lost to the mists of time. When it became apparent that he's not going to finish school and that his future lies in music rather than importing and exporting, his parents decide, all right, if he's gonna be a musician, he's gonna do it the right way. So they ship him off to Europe to study at some of the finest conservatories, Heidelberg, London, what have you. And when he gets back from Europe, he spends a number of years, by the way, here's a nice photo of him as a young man. He spends a number of years, basically, and I don't want to say this too unflatteringly, but basically being kind of a musical dilettante and a wealthy playboy. He works as a song plugger a bit like George Gershwin. He works as a rehearsal pianist on Broadway. He starts writing a few songs here and there, but nothing's very successful. He accompanies various vocalists. He does all sorts of manners of musical jobs. But apparently he's mostly just a kind of wealthy playboy having fun in New York. In fact, in 1915, he's hired by a theater producer named Charles Frohman to go to Europe with him to help sell some musicals as kind of a song demonstrator. But the night before they're supposed to set sail for Europe, Jerome Kern is out late partying, drinking, carousing, supposedly playing poker with friends, and he oversleeps and misses the Lusitania. Yes, indeed, the Lusitania, which of course was sunk by a German U-boat, killing hundreds, including the theater producer he was supposed to accompany. Now, the moral of that story, ladies and gentlemen, is that drinking to excess can save your life. See, you learn things here. Okay, he doesn't really have his first real success until he collaborates with another, with a lyricist with Jewish heritage. I won't say he's Jewish because he didn't consider himself Jewish, but a lyricist with Jewish heritage, Oscar Hammerstein II. Their first musical together is in 1925, a musical called Sonny, but it's not really that successful. No, he doesn't have his first hit until 1927, when he and Oscar Hammerstein II produced the musical Showboat, a game-changing musical in the history of Broadway. Yes, produced by Flo Ziegfeld, a Jewish producer. The Showboat is adapted from an Edna Ferber novel, and it deals with some serious topics. Dealt with race, intermarriage, marital discord, alcoholism. Showboat, in addition to being hugely successful, really accomplishes a lot of notable firsts for Broadway. First of all, it's the first Broadway musical, or at least the first hit Broadway musical, to deal with serious topics. And it's also generally considered the first real unified musical. What do I mean by unified musical? Well, early Broadway musicals were usually just basically a bunch of songs thrown together with an excuse of a plot to loosely tie them together. But most songs in early musicals were like non sequiturs. They would just, you know, they would come up with some excuse to have someone sing a song that a producer wanted to throw into a musical. Showboat is the start of a different trend, where the songs actually advance the story. And the songs serve the story. Yes, as Beth says, progress the plot. That, of course, is pretty much how almost every musical works since then. That starts with Showboat. And of course, Showboat spawns two massive hits, which instantly transform Jerome Kern from an unknown songwriter into a hot commodity, Old Man River, and Can't Help Loving That Man, sung in the musical by Helen Morgan, and then, of course, sung not by Ava Gardner in 1951. You know, this came out a few years ago. Ava Gardner never sang anything. A lot of starlets who are purported to have sung in the movies didn't sing. In fact, most of their vocals were done by a woman who was sworn to secrecy by the name of Annette Warren. Anyway, this musical is a huge hit, puts Jerome Kern on the map. He is 42 years old. Now, I'm not going to say that 42 is old. I'm going to get myself in trouble with a lot of people in this Zoom call if I say that. But honestly, in the entertainment business, 42 is pretty old to have your first hit. Most other, in every era of entertainment history, if you're going to hit it big, you hit it big before then. Let me play you briefly, and I'm not going to play all of it for you just because there's time. My favorite version of Can't Help Loving That Man, Miss Ella Fitzgerald from the Jerome Kern songbook. This is audio only.
Oh, listen, sister, I love my Mr. Man, and I can't tell you why. There ain't no reason why I should love that man. It must be something that the angels did plan. The chimney smoking, the roof is leaking in, but he don't seem to care. He can be happy with just a sip of gin. He can come home. as can be. Home without him ain't no home to me. Can't help loving that man. Oh,
yeah, I lied to you. I said I wasn't going to play the whole version, and I just couldn't stop it in the middle. I mean, it's just sublime. That's from the 1962 Ella Fitzgerald Sings the Jerome Kern Songbook. And by the way, that was a Nelson Riddle arrangement, and Nelson Riddle conducted on that album. I know this is beyond the purview of the class, but there is no better interpreter of the Great American Songbook than Ella Fitzgerald. I would even rate her above Frank, in my humble opinion, but my opinion is a very good one. And again, I don't want to go down this rabbit hole, but Ron put a comment in here. He said, I prefer when Ella sticks close to the melody without overdoing the scatting. You bring up a good point, and again, I don't want to get too sidetracked, but there's really two Ella Fitzgeralds. There's Ella Fitzgerald in the studio. Her studio albums, especially during the 50s and 60s, are basically pop records, wonderful pop records, but not jazz records, where she sticks close to the melody. There's not much improvisation. She has lush orchestral backing. She's basically like a female Frank Sinatra. But at the same time, there's Ella Live. When she's live, she tours with jazz musicians and jazz combos and is a consummate improviser. And it's really interesting. During the same time period, you have two Ella Fitzgeralds. You have Ella Fitzgerald in her studio albums, who's definitely a pop singer, like you just heard, and Ella Fitzgerald live, who's the consummate jazz musician. All right, look, back to Jerome Kern. A Jerome Kern throughout his career will collaborate with numerous lyricists, most of whom are Jewish. He has a big success in 1933 with the operetta Roberta, with lyrics by Otto Harbach. That musical spawns two big hits, the song Yesterdays, not even accused of the Beatles, it's multiple Yesterdays, and of course the aforementioned Smoke Gets in Your Eyes. It's sung in the 1935 film version by Irene Dunne, and then of course it becomes a number one hit in 1958, when the Platters record it. He collaborates with Dorothy Fields, a wonderful Jewish lyricist who I think I'm going to talk about more next week, because next week I want to get to some of the women. He writes a movie musical with her in 1936, Swing Time, which features a lot of great songs, including A Fine Romance, Pick Yourself Up, and then a song that wins the Oscars. We're talking about Oscars. A song that wins the Oscar for Best Song in 1936, The Way You Look Tonight. In fact, let's see that clip from the movie Swing Time, where Fred Astaire sings The Way You Look Tonight to a forlorn Ginger Rogers, who manages to, well, I don't want to give too much away. Let's show this clip. This is The Way You Look Tonight from Swing Time. Music by Jerome Kern, lyrics by Dorothy Fields. Notice she's got the shampoo in her hair. See how long it takes her to finish doing her hair.
Someday, when I'm awfully low and the world is cold, I will feel a glow just thinking of you and the way you look tonight. Oh, but you're lovely, with your smile so warm and your cheeks so soft, there is nothing for me but to love you just the way. With each word your tenderness grows, tearing my fear apart. And that love that wrinkles your nose touches my foolish heart. Love, never, never change. That breathless charm, won't you please arrange, 'cause I love you just the way you look tonight. Just the way you look
All right, sorry, that was not the clip where she does her hair in a remarkably short amount of time. In the fall of 1945, after spending some time in Hollywood, Jerome Kern returns to New York City to oversee a new revival of Showboat and to begin work on a new musical produced by Rodgers and Hammerstein, Annie, Get Your Gun. But November 5th, 1945, he's 60 years old, he's walking in Manhattan at the corner of Park Avenue and 57th Street, and he suffers a cerebral hemorrhage. He's identified only by his ASCAP card. In fact, he's initially taken to an indigent ward at City Hospital and later transferred to Doctors Hospital in Manhattan once he's identified. Oscar Hammerstein II gets there in time before he dies. He said he sang Jerome Kern's favorite song to him, I've Told Every Little Star, from Music in the Air. And that's when Jerome Kern stopped breathing. And of course, then Annie, Get Your Gun had to be scored by Irving Berlin. Of interest to only me, because I'm a clarinet freak, his daughter, Betty Jane Kern, was one of Artie Shaw's 8 wives. All right, we're running out of time. I want to get to at least one of the women tonight, because the women who contributed to the Great American Songbook get short shrift to this day. And the first of those ladies I want to briefly talk about is Miss Anne Rosenblatt, better known as Anne Runnell. Her dates, if you're a keeping track of dates sort of person, December 25th, that's an easy day to remember, 1905 to December 25th, 1993. I think it's highly considerate of historical figures to die on their birthday, because it makes it, you know, it's one less thing for us to remember. She's born in Omaha, Nebraska, to Morris and Molly Rosenblatt. She attends Wheaton College and then goes to Radcliffe College, the female auxiliary institution to Harvard, where she studies with the leading composition teacher at Harvard, Walter Piston, who, if you're into 20th century American classical music, you know who he is. He's a huge big deal. Well, one of the things she does while at Radcliffe is she writes for the school newspaper. And when George Gershwin visits Harvard and Radcliffe, since she has musical training, she is assigned by the paper to interview Mr. Gershwin. And he's the one who says to her, look, why don't you go into musical theater? He says to her pretty much explicitly, you know, you're going to have a really tough road if you want to become a female classical composer in this country. But if you come to Broadway, I can hook you up, and no one cares what gender you are as long as you got the goods, so to speak. He also, by the way, Mr. Gershowitz, encourages her to Americanize her name and Anne Rosenblatt becomes Anne Rennell. When she finishes Radcliffe, she goes to New York, and indeed, George Gershwin is good to his word and hires her as a rehearsal pianist for one of his musicals, Rosalie. And from then on, she would find work first in Tin Pan Alley and then in Hollywood. Probably her most famous song, or at least one of her most famous songs, is a song she actually wrote music and lyrics for and dedicated to her mentor, George Gershwin. And that's 1932's Willow Weep For Me. One of my favorite songs. In fact, in a minute, I think I'm going to play it for you to kind of wrap things up, because I love Willow Weep For Me. Now, Willow Weep For Me, although it's probably her most famous song today, wasn't her biggest moneymaker. What was her biggest moneymaker? Well, you'll probably recognize it. This is her biggest moneymaker. I can almost guarantee you that you recognize it. Hold on one second. Yes, indeed. In her Hollywood days, Anne Rennell wrote the songs for the Walt Disney Silly Symphony, including Who's Afraid of the Big Bad Wolf? That's Disney dollars right there. That made her more money than anything else. Now, a nice Jewish girl writing songs for pigs to sing? That doesn't seem that kosher to me. Nonetheless, we'll let that go. Let's go back to Willow Weep For Me, because we're running out of time here. Oh, let me quickly show you a picture of Anne Rennell. There she is. There she is. She would continue to work mostly in Hollywood. She did music, movie scores, because she could score. I mean, she had classical training. And like I said, she wrote both music and lyrics for a lot of her songs. She did marry a Hollywood producer of some renown, Lester Cowan. No children, though. And she lived until 1993. All right, we're running out of time. There's some questions and comments I got to get to in the chat. But before I do that, I'm going to play another song. And before I play another song, I'm going to say a couple of things. First of all, thank you for everyone who came tonight. Like I said last week, I know Zoom fatigue is real. I mean, this pandemic's been going on, I think, I don't know, something like 3 or 4 months now. We're all really tired of being on Zoom. So it means a lot to me that you guys were willing to spend a Wednesday evening with me in this manner. I also want to thank, of course, the Jewish Study Center. They're doing a lot of great stuff, both before, during, and hopefully after the pandemic as well. Jerry Garfinkel, Bracha, Mindy, everyone else with the Jewish Study Center. Make sure you check out all their other offerings. Go to their website, all that stuff. If you have any questions about the Jewish Study Center, put them in the chat. I'm willing to bet you'll get like 7 different answers. Look for me. No matter where you are, I'm around. I'm even traveling a bit more now. Best way to find out about me is go to sethkibel.com. Shockingly enough, that domain name wasn't taken. In fact, I'm really easy to track down because I've got an unusual name. The only other Seth Kibel in the world is a 22-year-old med student in Ottawa. Please don't bother him. He's probably taking all my gigs, but this is information on my albums and my performances and all that kind of stuff. I'd love to connect with you in the future, whether in person or virtually or what have you. Okay, as promised, I want to play Willow Weep For Me because I love this song. Thank you. Thank you. Willow Weep For Me. You know, if you want to hear a version of Willow Weep For Me that will make you completely forget what I just played, when you get off this, go to YouTube, Billie Holiday's version of Willow Weep For Me. It gives me goose pimples every time I hear it. All right, look, before I scroll through the chat, let me remind people that if you missed last week's segment, they've got it on YouTube. Maybe someone from the Jewish Study Center can put the link in the chat or something like that. And then there's another week coming up next week. I'm going to talk about Harold Arlen. I'm going to talk about Dorothy Fields. We'll see what else we have time for. That session is not on YouTube yet. Okay. Let me see what I got. Oh, someone asked earlier, and I think I didn't address this, about Ira Gershwin after George died. Ira Gershwin took a few years off. He was very shaken up by his brother's death. But then he did start writing lyrics again and collaborated with a number of songwriters. One of his most successful post-George collaborations is with another one of my favorite songwriters, another Jewish songwriter who maybe we'll talk about next week, Kurt Weil. They wrote some wonderful music together, Ira Gershwin and Kurt Weil. Let's see. Someone asked which came first in The Way You Look Tonight, the lyrics or the music? You know, I would have to look up that specific song. I would say that for these movie and Broadway shows, more often than not, the lyrics came first. But there are exceptions to that. There are definitely exceptions to that. But when you look up the history, a lot of these songs, a lot of times the lyrics did come first. If I had to guess, that would be the case with The Way You Look Tonight, but I could be wrong. Yeah, Billie Holiday did incredible stuff. And yes, her version of Willow Weep For Me was fantastic. There's some questionable stuff in The Three Little Pigs, The Silly Symphony. There's a lot of questionable Disney stuff that has thankfully been edited out. I mean, I can't believe that my parents took me to see Song of the South. Oh my goodness. All right. Anyway, have I missed anything important, Mindy, in the chat? Mm-hmm. Oh, would I consider doing? I've done.
Mindy, you're muted, Mindy.
You know, I'm already seeing a couple of comments. I love Kurt Weil, and I've actually done entire programs on Kurt Weil. So maybe I won't even do Kurt Weil next week, and maybe we'll do another program a few months down the line all on Kurt Weil, because I'm a huge... Kurt Weil had a fascinating life story and oeuvre. It spans the old world and the new world, Germany and the United States, and it also spans the classical realm and popular music, the Broadway stage and film. Fabulous composer and a really fascinating figure who literally escaped the Nazis in the dead of night. I'll just tease that there. Okay. Jewish Study Center people, anyone need to say anything before we wrap up?
I'll say a few things. First of all, thank you again, Seth, for another wonderful performance and very informative. Some of the comments said, you talked about how to find the recordings. Just go to our website, www.jewishstudycenter.org, and click on recording, and you will all the recordings. Tomorrow night is the last of the four sessions on Mishnah Berachot, a little different from Seth's stuff, but also a very, very nice class. And so I might see some of you tomorrow, and I hope to see most of you next week. That's it. Auf Wiedersehen.
Thank you so much.
And thank you, Brucha, also for volunteering to be the tech showman, and Mindy doing the intro. I appreciate everybody's efforts.
I will say this, Seth's presentation leaves so many interesting areas to explore, how the lyricists and the songwriters, the musicians got together, their challenges, their collaborations, their differences, how that really worked, these partnerships. Lots of stories there.
And maybe we'll do a program on Kurt Weill. He's one of my favorites also.
Okay. All right.
Okay, I think I'll end this now. See you all next week.